Yeah, can you? So welcome, Robert and Lieke, go ahead.
Thank you, Martijn, and thank you, Bea, for the background tech support. Welcome all who are interested in hearing about the presentation of Lieke and myself about our Dutch acceleration plan. We call it the Butterfly Effect 2.0, and it is referring to a presentation we had last year on the OU Global in Milan, where we also talked about the acceleration plan, but then the butterfly effect, it was 1.0, because we are now 1 year further. And in our presentation, we will tell you what we have accomplished this last year. Who are we? Lieke Rensink. Lieke Rensink is a part of our project, and she is working at SURF. And myself, I'm I have the honor to lead the project, and the project I will tell you about in a few minutes. This is the agenda we have to, for this this meeting. First, I want to tell you more about what is this acceleration plan for those who weren't visiting our presentation last year. What have we realized in 2020? And then I hope we can have some discussions about what do you think about this plan? What are your tips? What are your what do you think we are doing wrong? And do you have any suggestions? That will be in the end. First, about the acceleration plan. Acceleration plan is a Dutch collaboration between all universities of applied sciences in the Netherlands and also the universities, the research universities in the Netherlands. So a total of about 50 institutions. And also the collaborative ICT organization SURF, where Lieke is working, and our Ministry of Education, Culture and Science, who is financing this whole program. It's a four-year program running, started beginning of last year, and it will end at the end of 2022. So we are almost halfway now. The plan has divided in eight what is called zones, topic areas actually, and each zone has a team. They all are members from Dutch higher education institutions. Institutions could decide to connect to a zone and participate into a zone. And most of the institutions in the Netherlands are participating in one or more zones. Each zone has also a team captain and what is called a connector, and those are the roles, the team captain and the connector roles of Lieke and myself. Here is a picture about the organization of the zone. So you see the eight zones are those colored circles. And you see each zone where they are, what they are doing activities for. So for instance, the zone flexibilization is working on more flexible forms of offering education. The EdTech zone is looking into what can EdTech startups mean for adopting ICT and innovating ICT in institutions. And our zone is about digital educational resources. The complete name is towards digital and then open educational resource, and open is between brackets because we are not only talking about open educational resources, we are talking about all digital educational resources, and I'll come to that later. Well, in the, there is a program team and a steering group, which is more or less in control of the whole program, who is guiding and leading the program. And you see this, those little dots, those are the connectors. So this is Lieke. And there's also a support team, like communication, marketing, the secretaries to make appointments and organize all kinds of things, and the whole thing is led by a steering group and a program team. And this same program team is the program team which is here. So much about the organization. Our zone towards digital open education resources. They have 8 institutions participating in collaboration to the ambition we have set for our zone. And this ambition is this. So we have said, well, when this when we stop our activity, so at the end of 2022, teachers and students will have the opportunity in learning and teaching processes to easily determine and use their optimal mix of learning materials. So you see that that's our core course, the optimal mix of learning materials. So this optimal mix can contain a mixture of open and closed materials, digital and non-digital materials, dependent on, for instance, what students like, what teachers like, to have the best education possible. So this that is our ambition, and we have a kind of thinking model which decide on how can we accomplish this ambition at the end of 2022. And for us, the starting point is education. So our starting point is good education. And good education, in our view, follow the theory of the constructive alignment, in which the teaching and learning activities, the form of assessment and the learning outcomes are well aligned. And this is at the start of when you think about learning materials, because learning materials affect the bottom two. So the assessment have the effect on the teaching and learning activities, or are decided by, or are dependent on the teaching and learning activities you as a teacher design, and the form of assessment you want. That decide which learning activities or learning materials you will use. And these learning materials can be in a continuum of closed to open materials. When we talk about closed materials, so one side of the spectrum, then we talk about all the learning materials which are under no circumstances free, accessible, and reusable or adaptable. And in most cases, those are the commercial materials being available, and the open materials on the other side are what is called open education resources, for instance. So they are free to access and have the 5R rights. You can exercise and in which conditions are determined by the Creative Commons license, in most cases Creative Commons license, which are added to those learning materials. But there is also a range of materials inside. For instance, in our institution, Fontys University of Applied Sciences, we can buy licenses for certain learning materials from commercial vendors. And then for our students and teachers, those learning materials are within the borders of Fontys, free to use. So you can call it semi-open, or you can publish learning materials only within a certain group of users. For instance, in the Netherlands, there is an initiative for medical professions. They have their own repository of open learning materials, but those learning materials are only open for those within this community. This is also called a walled garden. So those we call in most cases semi-open. And let's see, then, because now I'm blocked by the this better. To use these learning materials or to access them, there is an infrastructure needed. And this infrastructure is both technical, so there's a technical infrastructure to get to use those materials, but also an organizational infrastructure, as research has shown. for teachers using digital learning materials. For most of them, that's rather new and innovative, and especially when it is open learning materials, they need support, and they support, for instance, on ICT matters, on IT matters, support on educational matters, and support on when it is open learning materials, copyright matters. But there is also needed an accommodating policy that this supporting structure is actually in place and available and guaranteed within an institution. And finally, when teachers and students will create their optimal mix of learning materials, they follow certain principles, and those principles can be very personal. For instance, teachers can ideally say, my preference will be for open learning materials because that's what I don't want to have. I don't want my students to pay for learning materials. And students can have a principle, for instance, well, my preference goes to video learning materials. So when they want to have a choice between, for instance, text or video, they will choose for video in the optimal mix of learning materials. Well, that's actually the framework, the thinking framework we use for all our activities we do in our project. So what have we done in 2020? Well, we have split up ourselves in working groups within our project, and these are the topics each of the working groups was working on in this year. So first, the support for a change process. As I said earlier, for most teachers, working with of making the change to work with digital learning materials or making the change to work with open learning materials is actually a change. It's a change which can be have cultural effects, which is a transition from an old to a new situation. And we want to support institutions in making this change. So we are working on toolkit that the institutions can use to accomplish this change. The second working group is working on stimulating reuse of learning materials, and they are focusing on the reuse of open textbooks. And what they have done this year is made an overview of all available of well, if it is all, I don't know, but they have looked into the most well-known repositories with open textbooks in the English language, and they have created a list of about 30 to 40,000 of those textbooks, and they want to describe each textbooks in terms that that for teachers who are looking for a replacement of their current textbook don't have a list of 20 best fit textbooks, but only get a list of 2 best fit textbook or 3 best fit textbooks, so that it is easier for a teacher to decide whether or not this open textbook is a good replacement for the book they are currently using. The third is the professionalize on working with OER. So this is a working group which is targeting to open educational resources. And because what we have noticed is that a lot of teachers have not sufficient skills to work with OER. They have trouble finding the right OER, they have trouble determining the quality of OER, and they don't know what is to be done with all those licenses. So that's so we are working on we have worked on a workshop, and this morning Dieke has presented in her presentation about together with a colleague of SURF about the workshop which is developed for this topic, and next year we will continue or we will follow up on this. A fourth is a group which is signaling an agenda setting, and what we have noticed is that there is going on a lot in the on learning materials all over the world, and what we are doing is monitoring all those activities, and when we think it is necessary or for the Dutch higher education to get connected to that, we try to get it on the agenda of the appropriate institutions or the appropriate groups which are for this for such a topic is available. For instance, what we have signaled is that a lot of recognition and rewarding using open learning materials or using learning materials as in a whole is something which is almost not available, which is almost absent in institutions, and we are now trying to put this on the agenda of a national initiative, which is done outside our zone and which is called Recognition and Rewards, which is working, striving towards another way of rewarding university people, and that not only publishing sufficient papers in peer-reviewed journal is the only way to assess their quality. And we try to get on their agenda also the rewarding for sharing open learning materials for this, or more broader for using the learning materials in a good manner and thereby creating good quality education. And working group communication dissemination is thinking about communication both about our zone and disseminating the results we have in our zone. And we are closely working together with the communication officer of the plan. The last two I've made bold, the towards efficient and infrastructure and content, because on those two topics, we want to go deeper into this presentation, and we start by the activity towards a vision. We have developed a vision with a horizon of 2025. And the reason is that using digital learning materials have both poses challenges but also poses opportunities. And board members of the higher education institutions, which are gathered in one of the zones, want to take action on this topic. So they gave an assignment, which is described here. And this assignment was given to our zone to develop such a concrete vision on how higher education can make optimal use of digital learning materials. We've created this vision document, presented it to the board members, and this vision document is available in the English translation very soon. As we speak, this translation is being made, and we expect that in very short time, next week maybe, this will be available on our website. In parallel, this board member had a second assignment, and that was a study to map the current situation, that's higher education. And our chief researcher, Ben Johnson, was the chief researcher, and we worked very closely together in this both trajectories, because of course this concrete vision was built on the results of their study. So this study made clear what the challenges and opportunities were, and our vision connected to that. Our vision, we have formulated our vision in 11 points of attention, in 8 vision statements and in 5 building blocks for realization, and we also gave a priority for our view. And we is a working group from our zone which created, which worked together this year to create this vision. And we used, and this is a kind of model to categorize all the information, because both in the research Ben has done, as in our assignment, there was a lot of information available, and to get an overview about this information, we devised this model, in which you see actually 2 dimensions. The first dimension is the level, which are the 3 circles we have distinguish between a micro level, which is the level of the individual teacher or student, We have the meso level, which is the level of the institution, and we have the macro level, which is the level of the collaborating institutions or SURF, or maybe the Dutch government, for which certain results or certain statements are valid for. And we also distinguish between six dimensions, six aspects, which you can distinguish when you work and think about learning materials. So we think about education strategy and policy, culture and human resource development, the organization of it, the technological infrastructure, economical and financial issues, and legislation and regulations. So this was the model both Ben used and we used to map our vision statements onto. And the vision statements we had created three visions on learning, three statements on the vision, about the vision on learning materials. Because one of the statements is that each institution will have formulated a vision on learning materials derived from the vision from on education. So there the thinking model I presented earlier, that your vision on education and the way you want education to be is leading for the way you want to learn, you want to use learning materials. So that is formulated in these vision statements, and it is not only that this vision is formulated, but also that it is implemented and known by teachers, and the teachers are acting according to. Those are the three vision statements about vision. We also created a vision statement on reward. I've told you earlier about this recognition and rewards initiative, and we think that rewarding teachers for their good education is crucial in their attitude in working with digital learning materials in an innovative and qualitative high way. And we think that is on a major level, because it is something institutions should devise. Then we also think there should be an organizational infrastructure for the things I've mentioned earlier, support teachers in their endeavors with their learning materials, and also to support students into it. And that is more than only the copyright experts. That's also the educational technologists. That's also the ICT departments, which are part of this organizational infrastructure. And also there is a national or institutional technical infrastructure for in which this mixture of this optimal mixture of learning materials can be used. And Lieke will go deeper into this after I've told you about this vision. We also think that instead of now, that payment by institutions of the learning materials would be a good thing to have, well, for two reasons. First, is more a reason for which is Dutch legislation. In Dutch legislation, you are not allowed to have students opt out for learning materials. When you offer or when you prescribe learning materials, students always should have an alternative for that. And in the old case, when you had analog books, then they could buy for it the secondhand books or go to a library and have books available there, or buy it from the fellow students who did this the same topic last year. But for digital learning materials, this is harder to have this license, which are in most cases personal, to fulfill this alternative requirement. And in our vision, when you pay as institution by this for this learning materials, the students don't have to buy them, and so they can use those learning materials. But the second is because when you as institutions pay these learning materials, the commercial vendors of learning materials, the publishers, will do business with you instead as an institution or as a collaboration of institutions, instead with individual teachers or students. And then you have a much greater force to accomplish changes. And for instance, and that's the last vision statement, then you have a force to create a system of arrangements together which can be followed by all institutions, and in which you have made arrangements with commercial publishers about, for instance, the terms for delivering of those educational learning materials, digital learning materials, and also about the used data, the data which is used and which are now which are used and are kept at the platforms of these commercial publishers, and you can make arrangements about this, and you are much stronger when you join forces than when you do that as individual institutions or worse, as individual teachers. So those were the reasons we created those two vision statements. And then we also devised five building blocks for which we think can be used to come from the current situation, or as our Eastern neighbors say, the East situation, to the 2025 situation, the soil situation in Germany. And every building block addresses one or more vision statements and touches on one or more points of attention. And here are those building blocks. So you see, for instance, that this vision and organization touches on three vision statements, and so the, all those dependabilities are made visible. And you also see that every vision statement is at least by one building block, is touched by at least one building block. And our priorities we have given to the board members is that first, work on this national set of agreements and this technical infrastructure. Second, work on an open model, both to stimulate using open educational resources, but also to have a good alternative which can be used next to commercial learning materials. For instance, when you don't have don't come to certain agreements with commercial publishers, you can use the open model as an alternative. You can devise this open model as an alternative for that. And the third is that we think each institution should prioritize working on this organizational infrastructure, and especially in the current case where we are almost completely going online. Well, the expectations are that somewhere in the next year sufficient vaccines will be available so that we can come out of this current situation, and then will everything go back to normal? And when everything is back to normal, current uses, or what current experiences with online education will survive. So will teachers actually go blended? But when they go blended, this the task for the organizational infrastructure to support those teachers will be much larger. So we think that that it is wise that institutions already invest in expanding their organizational infrastructure for when this crisis is over. And now I will give the floor to Lieke, who will talk about the infrastructure and content working group.
Okay, thank you, Robert. Yes, I will tell a little bit more about what we have been doing in the infrastructure and content work group. The group consists of five members from several higher education institutions and CERF. And together we try to achieve this goal. So we want to realize a nationwide infrastructure where teachers can find, create, edit, and share various forms of content in an open setting or closed with a group. And we focus on open educational resources, but also semi-open and commercial content. So it's the whole range. It's actually one-on-one with the vision Robert already mentioned. realize this infrastructure in 2020, we had a preparation year, we call it. So we first needed to obtain better insight into the exact needs of lecturers who want to jointly create and edit and share their learning materials. We focus on teachers working together with other teachers in their own fields, so really the professional communities and cross-institutional. And we see this really as the center of successful working on OER, so collaboration with like-minded peers. And this is our starting point. And we had four main activities in 2020. And the first was we conducted a requirement study. And the goal was to really get a supported set of requirements and methods for the infrastructure. And in order to gain that insight, we conducted the requirement study among 26 communities, professional communities, communities of lecturers. And we did this in a network. We had a network strategy. So we had a little group and they all knew some communities and they interviewed those communities. So that way we're building a community in this network. And also we invest in that network because they are going to be the users of our infrastructure. So we want to connect them now to this project and the work we are doing. We identified a clear need from both the technical infrastructure, and I will tell you a little bit more about that later. But not only the technical infrastructure, also the organizational services around the infrastructure were really important. A second part was content. So we did a desk research into available and relevant content and repositories, open and commercial content. And now we're developing a strategy to link the content, the commercial content, the open content, but also as a strategy for semi-open content to the infrastructure. We conducted several technical explorations. Actually, they're still going on right now. Around, for instance, collaboration tools and collaboration on specific content types. And it's all preparation for the innovation we want to do next year. And last is professionalization of the library staff by library staff, actually. So we're mapping current skills of the staff we're looking for gaps, how we can support them. Yes, so the activities in the workgroup infrastructure and content are really a joint effort from SURF and the zone. SURF is, Robert already said this, is the collaborative organization for ICT in Dutch education and research. We collaborate together because we want to make sure that all the national initiatives go into the same direction. SURF is doing stuff around OER, the zone is doing stuff around OER. So we want to make sure that everything is connected, what we're doing. And in recent years, SURF has developed an infrastructure with a focus on sharing and finding open educational resources. And this infrastructure will be made available from 2021 as a service for Dutch education. And the focus of SURF has been open, but because of the work together with also the zone, it's getting more and more a combination of materials. That's what we're focusing on now. But the starting point is the existing infrastructure of SURF as it is, but also from third parties. So what are we going to do in the next years? It says 2021, but actually it's also 2022. So we want to invest in innovation and we want to encourage the use of the infrastructure, of course. We are going to invest in support and another enter, please. So we also focus that on four activities. The first is innovation. So we want to further develop the existing infrastructure. And can you still hear me? Yes, okay, I heard a weird noise, I'm sorry. Okay, so we want to invest in the infrastructure. For instance, a dashboard for communities on top of the functionalities that already exist. For example, editing video, open textbooks, making, editing, publishing, collaborating on documents, but also issues of copyright and quality marks and version management are all topics that we are taking into account. And we're also looking at the commercial market, what is already what are already possible solutions that we can link to the infrastructure as is, and we want to conduct more technical explorations. In the activity around content, we really want to unlock the third-party sources of commercial and open content via the infrastructure that already exists. In the third activity, we want to invest in a support desk. We want to offer assistance with the implementation and the use of the infrastructure and content. We want to accelerate adoption and also coordinate the knowledge. There are a lot of different groups working on this, and we want to make it a network and really, really start working together and provide an adoption team for support and supporting materials. And to accelerate the adoption, we want to offer a package of instruments for institutions to get started. And you can think of instruments to set it up local, roll out the infrastructure, but also, for instance, help from the adoption team within your institution. This is all now in plans. So we're hoping to really do this. And the goal is in 2020 that we have 30 higher education institutions implemented the infrastructure successfully within the institutions in the Netherlands.
Lieke, there's a question from Bea, whether this is only focused on higher education.
Yes, both SURF and the acceleration plan are focused on higher education, but also at MBO can use the infrastructure, and PO and PO have their own in the Netherlands. Robert, maybe you can.
You are muted, Robert.
Still muted.
Yeah. Now, the primary and secondary education are they have their own infrastructure, which is. Maintained by KennisNet, and for instance, part of this infrastructure for the open educational resources is Wikibyte, a platform which already exists for 10 years. The vocational education, MBO in the Netherlands, they are partly supported by KennisNet and partly supported by SURF. So they will use both. They actually use Wikiwise, but they also, in my opinion, will make use of the infrastructure of SURF. But they currently have their own acceleration plan. So a year after we started in 2019, they have started in the beginning of this year with their own acceleration plan for innovation, educational innovation with ICT. So we are in contact with each other, but currently we have no joint activities yet because they have used this year to start up and had of course a lot of difficulties starting up because when they wanted to really start everything was locked down. Lieke, are you ready with your presentation? Okay. Then I will go to the second part of this workshop, and this is actually a question to you as audience. Well, you've heard what we are doing. You have heard the context in which we are doing all those things. Do you have any suggestions for us? Do you think watch out for certain pitfalls? Do you have maybe experience on some of these topics, and how did you do this in your context? So this actually is I want to give the floor now to the participants, and I will stop sharing the resources, but maybe a good start is to go into the chat window.
So Joost Grootkomelink made a nice remark, which might be a good point of discussion. Would this great initiative not be real success when students and professionals start to use it? Teachers can find each other probably already.
In higher education, and especially in University of Applied Sciences, the connection, connecting professionals with education is going on a lot. I myself, for instance, I'm connected to a project which has run for the last 3 years about nursing, the 17 higher education institutions offering a nursing program. And in nursing, a lot of the teachers are working part-time as a teacher and part-time working in practice. So there is these professionals are already collaborating with the teachers. I don't know how this is in research universities. I think the connection between institutions and the professionals in the field is not that close, but maybe, but correct me if I'm wrong, and maybe that is also dependent on the field. Management science topics, this will be larger than, for instance, in mathematics. I guess, but I think you have a good point, I don't know. It is a good point to take it into our plans. From how can we connect professionals to this infrastructure? For instance, as part of lifelong development programs. So yes, that's a good suggestion. Thank you, Joost. Yes, you're right. I see your comment, Joost, at the nursing. I thought this is great for professionals as well, and they actually are using it. And what we tried to accomplish last year, but which was not made easy because of this COVID things, but they will really do. What we are aiming at in the follow-up of this project is to connect professionals to the community of practice also, and reach out to those professionals. And we already have connections with the VNVN. That is the cooperation of nursing professionals, which has I think 200,000 members in the Netherlands. Can I send your question back at you? What are you finding difficult? Oh, is it not confusing in the platform includes? Oh, now I see two things. Can I send your question? What are you finding difficult? What I find difficult is the complexity of the field. As I try to see in this ordering model, there are so many aspects you have to take care of, and which is on so many levels, which are very interconnected with each other, where forces are playing, which are hard to get a grip on. I think that is I find that the most difficult, and how to unravel this complexity into manageable pieces so that you actually can make steps forward. Considering open learning materials, I think the adoption of it is, although we are working on it in the Netherlands for 15 years, it's still not at the level we maybe was. It is still not mainstream. And I know my teacher in OER, Fred Mulder, who's unfortunately passed away 2 years ago. He said when we started with VQWISE in 2009, that was a program of 5 years. He said, well, we at least need 20 years to also have this cultural change, and that openness is more or less into the is more a natural way to think than as something apart. And I think he's right. And in the last years, I also did some research about reusing OERs and how is it done. And we found out, for instance, that teachers in computer science are much more willing to reuse resources. And when I asked them for that, they said, well, that's something we are used to naturally, because when we are programming, we also look for resources. We don't program from scratch. We are reusing pieces of code and mix them together to programs. And and we do the same for learning materials. And that was, for instance, compared to nurses, nursing educators, there was this amount of reusing much on a much lower level when we measured that. And we put it in a paper, and somewhere in the coming days, this paper will be published in Open Practice. So keep that platform, keep your eyes on that platform.
On the note of, you know, the nursing project, Mathilde Smith asked, are there OE practitioners, sorry, working with clinical programs?
I don't know. I don't know if that is the case, because I don't know what the clinical program is.
Right. Just before, Joost commented, is it not confusing when the platforms includes also both closed and commercial materials at the same time?
That will, of course, or I think that will certainly be confused when you have one point of access to all these kinds of learning materials. And we have to think about then how to make this confusion less. Maybe Lieke, can you react on that?
Also? No, we don't really have ideas about that yet. It's about when you go to the search engine and you're searching, you get the materials, but some also are semi-open. That's also confusing that you cannot reach those materials either. So we're looking into it also on a technical level, but that's really in 2 years' time we will be there, and not yet. So if you have ideas, please share. And we have a team of people who help us, like the network, to make it better. So they will start using it, and then we will find out what will work and what won't work. And
Eric Worth said, on the model earlier of effective teaching in regards to the continuum of closed to open materials, have you mapped out where various types of materials may fall? I am thinking about public domain, materials free online that are copyrighted, content licensed differently, such as those with non-derivative. I know you mentioned that material purchased by a library would be towards the middle.
We have not made that mapping. I don't think if it will be really really felt. But for students, it is not an issue at all, because students, they use everything they they find on the internet and which is valuable for them, and they don't look at any licenses. And also teachers, although they are aware of licenses, even if they are aware of licenses, the research I talked about a bit earlier found out that that only one third of the teachers who are aware of licenses actually act accordingly. And there is no difference if they are reusing the learning materials with or without adaptations. They are not looking at any license at all. In many cases, open access only without the aim to change the materials or to adapt the materials is sufficient for situations. So therefore, I don't know if the if it will be very worthwhile to make this mapping, because in each context for each individual that could be different. Of course, not for the things like public domain or etc., which are always on the most right part, the OER part of the spectrum. But for all the things in the middle, people use it if they can, or, and if they are allowed to, and if they are not allowed for certain types of use, like adapting, they should be geared to materials which they are allowed to adapt, and there a library can have can be a huge support to help those teachers and to find it out with them. That's how I feel about it.
Practically, you offer the materials based on content, for instance, and then it has a price which is closed or open, but it's the content that matters.
Yeah.
Some links have been shared by Robert and Alike in the chat, and I saw a question from Bea.
Yeah, nice question, Bea. Well, when you share your materials, when you're working for the TU Delft, I think when you create your materials for the TU Delft, the TU Delft is the owner of the materials. So when you change employment, go to Leiden, you are still you have your intellectual property right, so you can maybe recreate that those learning materials, and then you use it in Leiden. I don't know.
I didn't mean to actually open that kind of worms. No, I was more thinking in terms of. You're absolutely right. So if I create something for when I'm working for Delft, then the copyright stays with Delft, but I would still have moral rights over the material. So I could still use the materials that I created, I'm thinking, right? So my question was more towards, and correct me if I'm wrong, because I'm getting this completely wrong, but so if at the moment I have access to SURF, for example, because I am employed by one of the higher education institutions in the country, but if I stop employment, and it has happened in some of the projects when we lose one of the student assistants, for example, that was a postgraduate working in one of our projects, and they created something and then they stop. They're not with the university anymore and they go somewhere else. It's like we this person pretty much loses access to SURF unless they go to a higher education institution in the Netherlands where maybe they can actually, you know, but they would be creating a new space in SURF and not, see what I mean? What I'm getting at is this idea of continuity.
You have a good point, and maybe that's something maybe also SURF would, I don't know if SURF is thinking about this, that SURF is something from collaborative, is owned by the institutions, the collaboration of all the higher education institutions in the Netherlands, and then you are only thinking about the regular education. So the education you receive as a student between 18 and 24 years, for instance. But the same institutions are also have their alumni. The same institutions also offer programs for professional development in lifelong learning trajectories. And maybe SERV should also consider to support those people who were once in an institution but left this institution because they were ready and still have their services also made available for them. That will change also their business model, I think, because currently the services, some of the services are free and fall into a certain package which are offered for all institutions for one price, and some of the services you are extra services from SERV and you have to pay this for an institution to use them, but how about services offer them for people and keeping them open for people who are not all already? I think that's a good question. And Lieke, I don't know, is SERV thinking about all these kinds of things?
Lieke needs to connect. Wait a second.
Sorry, I have hearing issues. I'm sorry.
Technical difficulties, yeah. Just give her a sec. Yeah. We cannot hear you yet.
Yes, I'm back.
Yeah, there you are.
Oh, sorry. I missed the question. I'm sorry.
Okay. The question was, is SERV thinking about expanding their services to, for instance, people who were once working at the university or university of applied sciences, or are students studying there and had access to those services, but expanding the services to people who are not anymore in this field, lifelong learners or so?
I think we have to discuss this with each other, because also I think it's important also for the community focus. When you work together, what was the discussion earlier on, when you work in a community, it's not only people within the higher education institutions. So they also need access to the systems. So yeah, I can imagine that there will be different kinds of access to the infrastructure. But I think we need to discuss this more, because my colleagues from SERV, they know more about this, but I don't think it's on the roadmap yet. But we'll take it into account, yes.
And we could use discussions in SERV. And I think Ben added a good comment on this. And it's both has to do with, you know, the copyright of whatever comes in, let's say, and accessibility and showing what goes out, more or less.
Yeah, but the question of Bea goes further than just the resources, but also to services around those resources, as I understood well. Some of the services, for instance, service portals or community portals or so. And it's right what Lieke also mentioned, when we think about broadening communities, community of practice with professionals in the field, then these professionals should also have access to services which are used by this community. And that is that's a way of thinking. I don't know if SERV is already thinking about it. I think maybe from another zone where they are talking about more flexible learning paths for students. They are researching now for different scenarios, where one of the scenarios is students working in the field and also learning partly in the field, because he or she is working and sometimes going back to the institution and take some courses and then go back to the field and take that as a path to eventually come to a degree. And that, though, in those kinds, the same students in the meantime, when they are not connected to an institution, should have access to services also, and not only to resources. And I think it is not fair to say, well, publish everything openly, because then you don't have this thing, because everything open, in many cases, that is not possible. And in many cases, there are absolutely fine closed learning materials, which are very, which are hard to refine. I don't know the English words. To replace with open resources, because of the for instance the platforms needed to play this content. Another thing Bea said, I think a focus in higher education fine, but at the same time, can we try not to exclude other types of education? I absolutely support that, Bea, and I know that on the field of learning materials, and I see Jan Bart de Vrede is also present here in the audience. Jan Bart from KennisNet and SURF are very are working closely together on this infrastructure, so there is actually, for instance, the nursing community is publishing their learning materials on Wikiwise. And there are more communities in higher education using Wikiwise to share their learning materials. So I absolutely agree with you. Ben and me did some research a couple of years ago for focus on the area of technical vocational education training. And there we noticed the same thing, that this area, technical vocational education training, is largely underserved by the open community. We noticed that, and we also made note of that. And so the focus of the whole open community should maybe be less on higher education solely. And I think the expansion of focus from OE Globe, from the Open Education Global to K-12 education, for instance, is a good way to go that far and to go there, to that road. But maybe it should be done more and more, done more research into those areas on open, and not only focus your research on openness in higher education. But now I'm diverting from the topic we are discussing now.
We have plenty of time to do that, so it's valuable. Maybe Jos has to leave. If you want to discuss further, maybe you want to go back to the how do you call it, the topic that you showed in your presentation to have the discussion on?
You mean the last slide?
Yeah. Or do you feel like you've discussed enough?
I feel if there are no other suggestions or tips or pitfalls, we got a lot of suggestions and thinking points to work, to take with us in the remainder of the crisis. Yes, I'm happy with it.
Right.
How can we help further, Bea? Good question. Maybe we can when appropriate. We can contact you for support, or when we think something can be useful. I see Nick nodding also.
She says chat over a beer, and I'm saying yes, let's do that.
Oh, chat over a beer, yes, of course. Chat over a beer, some bites. Yes, bitterballen.
Gino will provide the catering.
Okay.
I guess, thank you then for presenting. Some of the, in the chat, you shared a couple of links. Do share them in your, underneath your abstract on the Connect platform as well. I'll put it in the chat here. You are okay with closing, or is there anything else you want?